Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the second meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2023. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. Are the committee in agreement to take items four and five in private? Agenda item four is an update to the guidance on committees, and agenda item five is the consideration of a paper on parliamentary privilege. Are the members of the committee in agreement to take that in private?
Yes.
Excellent. Agenda item two. Our second item is in respect of correspondence that we have received from the conveners group on strengthening net zero scrutiny arrangements. Do members have any comments on the correspondence? Bob, can I come to you?
Thank you, convener. I found the correspondence really informative in relation to the ambitions of the conveners group and the wider parliament to embedding scrutiny of net zero not just into the work of the Net Zero Committee, and acknowledge the convener is with us today and sits on this committee, Mr Mountain, but of all parliamentary committees as we scrutinise legislation. So whilst the letter from the Conveners Group was informative, it also said the group noted that it was important that the Scottish Government was able to provide essential data to facilitate this scrutiny work. With this in mind, you will have seen the correspondence that I have had with the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero requesting better information on this. The group will return to this at our meeting later this month. I've not seen that correspondence, convener. I'm unaware if the Scottish Government has replied or otherwise to that correspondence. And I think those are two essential pieces of evidence that I would like to see before making a specific commitment to do further work in relation, or deciding what our further work may look like and our approach to any changing of standing orders and rules in this place with regards net zero.
That's very helpful. Do we have any other comments? No? I mean, I think it would seem sensible, given that this committee is talking about the procedures to arrive at something, actually to know what wants to be arrived at would be helpful for the committee. So are the committee in agreement that we correspond back with formally with the conveners group to get access to all of the correspondence and, if necessary, the Scottish Government? And at the same time, would the committee be in agreement to writing to the requisite committee, indeed to ask what their views and asks are? Are we happy with that?
Agreed. Yes.
I'm grateful. Agenda item three is correspondence that we've received from the presiding officer on a request for to vary the proxy voting scheme, which, as we know, has only just come in this year, but as we have all seen, been successfully used within the chamber on a number of occasions. Do members of the committee have any comments on the correspondence from the presiding officer, or are we in agreement with her proposal to vary it? Edward?
Thanks, convener. This is a really difficult subject in my mind, and I know probably every member has had to experience this at some stage. What I'm keen to do is ensure that that we're seen to be fair and reasonable and in line as well with what's expected for people outside this parliament in regard to bereavement. I know rules have changed, and I know that there are some stipulations about what you can expect and what you can't expect. So I'm quite keen to understand what other people across Scotland are given in relation to this, to make sure that the Parliament is in line with that, or at least understands when we make this decision that we're making it in light of what other people are having to face. That's the first point, if I may, convener. The second point is, and I know you're going to give me a rap across the knuckles for this, but it gives me the opportunity to mention the fact in the letter that, in the scheme which I've mentioned to you outside this committee, is I think the way it's written about the designation of a proxy on the bottom of page four of our papers, it says the designation of a proxy must be made by the Member of the Parliament by email account by 10 a.m. on the Tuesday. Now, my understanding of what we decided and agreed within this committee was that it could be for a period of time. The way this is written seems to infer that a member must notify every week the presiding officer that they wish a proxy. Now, I just know that there are circumstances when that might not be possible. And therefore, I wonder if when we're doing this, we could write to the presiding officer and say that a member may apply for a proxy for a period of time and then would have to reassess it. For example, you may be going into hospital on a Friday. You may have a serious operation which takes you past the Tuesday deadline, which means that you won't be able to apply for that proxy. And I'm not sure that's what we meant. I'm not sure that's necessarily the way it will be interpreted, but it's the way it's written, Convener. And I just wondered if we could flag that up at the same time.
No, that's very helpful. And if I deal with that second point before your first point, my understanding is that the proxy scheme is operating as we thought it was going to operate. But I know your concern with regards to the actual wording in the voting scheme, and I'm more than happy to write to seek clarification, because you will recall that we tried to frame it to give the widest possible opportunity for the presiding officer to reach the right decision on individual cases without having to seek medical advice, additional information, and to rely on that. I'm more than happy to do that. Just before dealing with your first question, first point, which I think was sort of hinting at seeking more information before reaching a decision, I don't know whether any other members would like to come in, and then I'll come back to that if that's all right.
Bob. Thanks, Convener. So this is specifically on the variation of the proxy voting scheme the presiding officer is suggesting. Can I just check for clarity? I'm sure the answer is yes. The letter from the presiding officer, Annex A, is a publicly available document, that letter. The reason I say that, Convener, is it refers to two colleagues who had a loved one nearing end of life or at end of life and seeking the use of the proxy voting scheme in those circumstances. I think it's unanswerable that would be the right thing to do. What I hadn't realised was that the pilot scheme that our committee had agreed to didn't build in that flexibility and discretion already for the presiding officer. And but that's okay, because we always said this would be an iterative process as we went along, and we would shape it to reflect circumstances and as they develop. I would be keen to clarify changes to the proxy voting scheme that would be allowed. My personal circumstances, if I'm allowed to share, Convener, is that when my mother was approaching the end of life, the SNP Whips team were wonderful, and I got to spend the last week with my mother. There was no pairing, there was no proxy. But can I say, as I sat by my mother's bedside, I was still on my phone doing my work, clearing emails, to be quite honest with you. And I would have liked to have had a proxy to not feel excluded or remote from the Parliament, but to have that link, but not dependent on logging on to vote virtually, but to allow a trusted colleague to vote on my behalf and permit me to do that. I think this proxy scheme should cover such circumstances, and if the presiding officer doesn't think there's suitable flexibility at present, then I think we should agree to changes to provide that flexibility.
That's very helpful, thank you. Anson, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I understand where we are with all of this, Convener. I think it is important. Now, we said at the outset that we needed to be sensitive to the members, and we needed to understand how it would work in practice, and we are now in that situation of it working in practice. So it is giving us an insight into the complexities or the necessities that require to be managed when someone has a situation or circumstance that require them to have that. So I like Bob, think that we should be realistic about what we're trying to achieve here. We're not trying to put barriers, we're not trying to put any areas where we think it's not the case. We should be trying to encompass, but at the same time we need to be sensitive to what is required for the Parliament, but also what is required for the member to ensure. And as Bob has said, you know, having that opportunity of not having to rush back and do things and continually think about, well, is this going to happen But if you have someone there who you know and you trust to give you that and is supporting that, then that takes some of the pressure off. And that's what we're trying to do here. We're trying to alleviate the pressure on the member so that their work can be done, but in the voting system and in the practical side of things, that they are supported and they have the confidence that that's taking place on their behalf. And that's what I wanted out of this whole process, and that has been achieved.
Yeah, I think that's very helpful. Colette, do you want to contribute? And then I'll come back to you.
Yeah, Colette. I completely agree with Alexander and what you were saying. I think it is a very sensitive subject, and I think the fact as well that it is still a pilot scheme and this has cropped up is an ideal situation to absolutely look at it as well. The other thing what Edward mentioned about the actual, you know, the notification. I mean, you could be dealing with somebody who has to go abroad to deal with a relative. There's, you know, time differences, notwithstanding, you know, having to go into hospital and things like that as well. So I think we wholeheartedly encompass that and make sure that, yeah, we deal respectfully and dignified with people who are, you know, are dealing with relatives who are going through end of life as well. So, yeah.
That's helpful. Bob, did you have a comment? Then I'll come back to you, Edward.
Yeah, I think Edward Mountain was saying within his initial comments, and I'm sorry, Edward, if I've captured it inaccurately, that we should look to see what happens elsewhere. One thing I don't know is, we sit talking about getting effectively working conditions right for MSPs to be supportive. I have no idea what rights the wider parliamentary staff have when they have the exact same life circumstances. I don't know if we have a role in relation to drawing to the corporate body's attention that we are seeking to consolidate what we think should be key rights within the workplace for MSPs, and we're just wondering how that's mirrored within the wider rights extended to staff within this place. We won't all be employed by the corporate board. There'll be a variety of contractual arrangements there, but I'm just conscious that we're not the only people working in this parliament.
Thank you. Edward, did you want to come back in just before?
Yeah, look, it's really, really difficult, this, because, you know, no one wants to stop you being next to a close relative when they're nearing the end of their life. And I accept that, having lost both my mother, my father. You know, I understand how important it is to be there and the extended amount of time that I needed to be with my father. I think I'm just wanting to understand what we mean by close relative and how then the presiding officer is able to make that judgment, because I really want to see people spending the time that they need. I just would like to understand slightly, because we're putting the presiding officer in a slightly difficult position by saying, are you going to decide who's a close relative?
If I can sort of bring some of the threads of that together, I think what we need to remember, of course, is that we empowered the presiding officer to come up with the scheme so that it would work not for the presiding officer, but would work for the chamber. And we empowered, and I think rightly so, the presiding officer to have that flexibility. And certainly the scheme that has been created rests with the presiding officer. And the obligation is that on the presiding officers to come back and consult with us, which I think talks volumes about the evaluation of how this pilot project is going on, and it was always considered, I think, by this committee to be an iterative process as we developed it. And I certainly feel that the confidence that the chamber has shown in the presiding officer in creating this should probably be echoed in this committee with regard to requests that she makes to us. That doesn't mean that, notwithstanding the request has been made, we look at the consequences of this. And I think that goes to some of what you were talking about, Bob, about starting now perhaps to reach out to find out what the situation is wider afield. I think what the experiences of those people who have both been proxies and offered proxies and exercised proxies would be valuable to catch at the time. As to the extent and the clarification that the presiding officer would use to decide next of kin, I think if you recall the quite substantial evidence that we heard about in relation to the caring situation that people have, which is not necessarily defined by, you know, a family link or something like it's a circumstance of fact, and that we entrusted the presiding officer with regard to that. And since she's seeking this clarification, clearly because of events that have been presented to us, I would hope that we could support the change that she proposes, but then use that as the start of this evaluation process. Because, you know, I mean, I suppose it's because we are in the second month now of the proxy, and I think to some surprise, the use of it has exceeded certainly my expectation, I have to say. And I think it would be meritorious to seek the clerks to start capturing the evidence of how this is playing out so that we can review this in due course. Bob, did you want to come back in?
Convener, I think it is a relevant point when we're looking at whether we should put structures or definitions or criteria around who qualifies as a close relative. I think we've set a precedent already when we looked at adoptive and foster parenting, where we also included kinship. And kinship doesn't always mean blood relative, or it's a wider, looser term that acknowledges that relationship of love and care that you can have with someone else without defining that specific relationship in particular. So I think we've already taken a more permissive and flexible view, and I don't think it would serve as well to define that. I think we either give discretion or we don't, and I think we've given discretion to the presiding officer, and I have every faith that I'll be exercised appropriately.
Colette, you want to come in?
Literally was just going to say what Bob just said about discretion. I know that you know, from my own personal experience when my brother died as well, and it was down south, and just due to the complexity of it, it was 3 weeks before we could actually, you know, bury him as well. So, you know, my employees at the time, or employers, sorry, at the time, were fantastic and gave me 3 weeks off. So while there was policies in there, and I know there was policies within the local government in terms of what time you're, you know, allowed to have off for, you know, particular relations, there is an element of discretion there, and I would definitely go a veer towards that in terms of allowing the presiding officer to use that discretion. And, you know, and it's very subjective as well. So,
On that point, then, are we agreed that we support the request for the PO for the amendment, but we clarify the understanding with regard to the designation of a proxy, which I think is a valid question, but also we instruct the clerks to start the capturing of evidence for the evaluation that we need to take. As a committee, are we content on that? Or?
Yeah, agreed. Yeah.
Bob, do you want to?
I apologise. A little bit of mission drift, but I was reflecting on the point that I know it's proxy voting we're looking at, but what we're looking at is one group of workers in this parliament getting more flexible working to suit or personal circumstances at the point of bereavement, end of life, and when bereavement occurs. And there are whole groups of workers employed within this parliament that we're not directly responsible for as a committee convener, but it might be worthwhile drawing what I think is the progressive nature of how we're seeking to support MSPs in such circumstances within this parliament to the attention of the corporate body, and asking them to reflect on that in relation to the wider workforce within this place.
I certainly see no challenge, because obviously corporate body as an entity would be one of the people that we would be seeking input with regard to the evaluation of the proxy voting. And I am, of course, aware of a number of strands of correspondence that we have with the with the corporate body at the moment about a number of matters, but I would see no harm in, and if you're content, Bob, I'm happy to write to the corporate body just to express where this comes from, what it's about, and what their thoughts are on it, not because it falls directly within the remit of this committee, the employment and contractual relationships between the corporate body and other members of staff here, but to reinforce the approach that as a parliament we are looking for a developmental iterative approach to employment that's supportive, or as widely supportive as possible, in order for us to get our jobs done.
Thank you for taking it forward on that basis. Sometimes we, politicians as a class, are not particularly seen to have self-awareness. So given the fact we're looking at effectively our working conditions, I think we should show a degree of self-awareness as we take it forward.
That's helpful. Edward.
Camina, just before we leave this, just on a general way the proxy voting systems work. First of all, I'm delighted it's being used so much. It actually shows the need of why we needed it, and I think the committee's done a good job by introducing it. So that's the first point. The second point, though, very interesting, when I was watching it being used in the chamber in relation to one member, on short votes at decision time, the member who was using it said, on behalf of X, I vote yes, which I think is entirely right. And I would encourage that, because then it allows people who are watching to understand who the proxy vote is for. So I personally would encourage that. And when it comes to stage three debates in the chamber, it becomes very difficult to do that. So I just wondered, as the presiding officer allows the situation to evolve, whether it would be worth at the outset making the point that during this vote there will be a proxy vote, which I will call in each time on behalf of so-and-so, and the person will be exercising that. So it then cuts the time the presiding officer does. But what I do want to stress is I think it's really important that on short votes and at decision time on a normal evening, that the member is named so that his constituents or her constituents can see that that person has made a positive decision in relation to the vote and is seen to be participating in events.
I think that's very helpful. And I think, you know, the discussion that was had about how we capture the proxy vote, which ended up in what we saw certainly in the early stages of the first proxy vote, where an explanation was given, the name of the member and the way the vote was cast could be captured on the official record. Again, as an iterative approach, I think what you say about stage three will no doubt be being looked at. And I think, again, that's helpful if we start the capture of the evidence to be able to start to consider this for how proxy voting goes forward, because there was a challenge in stage three about it. And I don't know what the correct answer is, but having had the very strong discussions that we had about ensuring that the vote is captured, the explanation of why a different member was casting it, I think, you know, goes to the heart of the reason that, goes to the heart of why proxy voting was so important to bring in here. So that was helpful. Colette, did you want to?
Just a suggestion, really, on the back of what Edward said, because it was very repetitive at stage three. I'm just wondering, like, you know, say the, initially, you know, what MSP you're acting as a proxy for and the area in which, you know, the constituency or region that they cover. But could we possibly, going forward, maybe use a placard or something rather than having to constantly say, you know, because it did seem very, very repetitive, and it was quite, I thought it kind of prolonged the process when we were voting each time.
I think you're right, absolutely right to raise it, Clint. I think this is part of the evaluation, because the committee will also be cognizant that come the summer recess, the actual procedure, or sorry, that the apparatus of voting will change in the chamber. And because proxy voting as a pilot exists beforehand, I would hope that there was a way of being able to perhaps use the new facilities to capture that, which may alleviate some of the time spent, particularly at stage three.
They're very, very sensible suggestions. At stage three, we have groupings of amendments, so it might be advantageous to announce something at the beginning of the groupings or the end of the groupings that this will take place, and that may then cover the number that are in the grouping. If that would alleviate the timescale, that might be a suggestion that could be thought about.
Again, incredibly helpful. Well, if we're in a... Oh, sorry, Bob. Didn't just get across you.
Apologies, I'm testing your patience this morning, Convener. I think I was kind of holding back from seeing this. My colleagues have kind of said it's kind of can't help but want to be part of the discussion, so I apologise for that. I wonder if, and Mr. Minton's right, I think, where it's not a stage three process and there's a limited number of votes, a clear declaration from the proxy as to how that vote's been cast openly and transparently in Parliament is absolutely the way to do it. But there must surely be, after a clear statement at the start of a period of voting, an IT solution to this. I won't tell you what my IT solution would be. I think we'd leave that to IT individuals to come forward to suggest to us what that would be. But there must surely be an IT solution, because we all don't have to do a roll call vote at stage three. So why should the individual with the proxy vote be any different? Why should that be a roll call vote and everyone else's deliberative votes are not done in that way? So actually, on an equitable basis, after that initial declaration, I think an IT solution would be the most effective way forward.
I certainly think being able to frame the question that we want to seek of the new equipment as we vote is helpful. And again, as we were talking beforehand about unknown unknowns, until we had this proxy pilot, I don't think anyone had really considered the situation at stage three as compared. I think people have a view of something when you're talking about it, and actually an iterative piloted approach allows you to go, oh, and how's it going to work in this circumstance? And I think that's something that we can both capture but can also put in place, so that hopefully we have an answer towards the end of this pilot about what something more formalised going forward would look like. So that's helpful. So are we in agreement to confirm to the presiding officer that we're in agreement with the amendment that she seeks, but also seek the additional information that we've also reiterated today? Good. I'm grateful for that. That concludes the elements of the public part of this meeting, and I will now move us into private.